Good morning. The topic for today is maxillary sinus or disease of maxillary sinus. So by the end of the topic, you'll be able to describe the signs and symptoms originating from the antrum and those arising due to dental cause. You'll be able to recognize the situations where dental surgery might be complicated by creation of an oral antral communication or displacement of foreign body or a tooth into the maxillary antrum. You'll be able to explain how to treat a newly created oral antral communication or a foreign body displaced into the antrum, and also how to minimize these complications. And also you'll be able to categorize various treatment available for oral antral fistula. Before we start, to just go through the basics. So what is sinus? So it's a cavity or a substance of a skull bone that usually communicates with the nostrils and contains air. So maxillary sinus, also known as antrum of Haimur, it's the name given after it was described in 1651 by Haimur. So it is the largest paranasal sinuses that communicates with the other sinus through the lateral wall of nose. The other paranasal sinuses are frontal, ethmoidal and sphenoidal. So it is two in number, one on either side of the maxilla. So the dimensions of maxillary sinus are 3.5 cm anterior-posterior, approximately 3.2 cm height and 2.5 cm width. The volume of the maxillary sinus is around 15 to 30 ml or milliliter. The ostium of the sinus is 3 to 6 mm and opens in the middle meatus at the posterior end of the hiatus semilunaris, which is on the medial wall of the nose. So ostium is the opening where the sinus drains. So the maxillary sinus drains into the middle meatus in the lateral wall of the nose. So talking about the anatomy of the maxillary sinus, so it's pyramidal in shape with the base, apex and four sides. The base is formed by the lateral wall of the nose, the apex is formed by the zygomatic process of maxilla, the roof is formed by the floor of the orbite, floor by the lateral part of the hard palate and the alveolar part of the maxilla. The posterior wall separates sinus from the infratemporal and pterygopalatine fossa. The anterior wall is formed by the facial surface of the maxilla. So when you're talking about anatomy, you should know about the nerve supply, blood supply, venous drainage and lymphatic drainage. The nerve supply is through the superior dental nerve and the greater palatine nerve. The blood supply is through the intraorbital artery, posterior superior alveolar vessels. So the venous drainage is through the anterior facial vein, angular vein, inferior ophthalmic vein, and the maxillary sinus drains into the submandibular nodes. This is the representation of a radiograph, a skull and the soft tissue. So you can see a yellow line that is drawn over the frontal sinus, ethmoidal sinus and the maxillary sinus. There is one sinus that is missing in this image, is the sphenoidal sinus, which forms a part of the paranasal sinuses, which can be viewed in a sagittal section rather than the frontal view. This is the frontal view of the skull. So you can see the sagittal view, you can see the volume of the whole maxillary sinus and their extent. And the second picture represents a axial view of the maxillary sinus in the anteroposterior direction. knowing about the growth of some axillary sinus, it develops as an invagination from the lateral sinus during the 70th day of gestation. At birth, it is 2 cm long, 1 cm broad, and 1 cm high. At 12 years, it reaches 2/3 of the size. The sinus floor parallels the floor of the nasal cavity. By 15 to 18 years, adult size sinus flow below the level of the floor of the nasal cavity. And pneumatization continues as age advances. So pneumatization is changes in the maxillary sinus still continues as age advances based on the posterior molars that is present. The pneumatization continues. Talking about the microscopic anatomy, it is lined by the respiratory epithelium, which is called the Snyder's membrane. It is the mucus secreting pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium. Coming about the functions of the maxillary sinus, the most important one is it imparts resonance to the voice, it increases surface area and lightens the skull, moistens and warms the inspired air. The mucociliary mechanism helps to remove the debris, bacteria, etc. from the inspired air, create air padding and thermal insulation to the forebrain, olfactory region, etc. It helps to determine the position of the orbit cavity and hence the eyes. Clinical examination. You look for the pain, tenderness and swelling over the prominence of the cheekbone. Intraoral examination, you look for pain and tenderness, swelling over the maxilla between canine fossa and the zygomatic buttress. Gives any anomalies of the maxillary sinus, extraorally and intraorally. The investigations, the common that has been performed is the transillumination to see the cavity of the maxillary sinus if there is any growth inside. Or if you want to have any bony changes, then you go for extravirial view like osteotomental view, lateral scale view, submetavertex view, linear tomography, OPG. And intraoral views are occlusal view, lateral occlusal view and periapical view. The normal anatomy or the normal antrum of a maxillary sinus will be radiolucent and it will be outlined by a cortical bone. If there is going to be any pathology, then there will be thickening of mucosa of the bony walls, air fluid level, complete opacification of the sinus and disruption of cortical outline. So if these findings are there in the radiology or the investigation what you have advised, then there is an underlying pathology of the maxillary sinus. So you can see the normal anatomy on the left side, whereas an arrow pointing on the right side has got some amount of radio opacity, which indicates and underlying pathology. Talking about the infections of maxillary sinus. So if there is an odontogenic sinusitis, it's an inflammation of the mucosa of any of the paranasal sinuses. Pansinusitis is the inflammation of all the paranasal sinuses, as I already mentioned, like frontal, ethmoidal, sphenoidal and maxillary sinus. So the infections of maxillary sinus can be classified as acute and chronic. Acute can be subclassified as suppurative and non-suppurative. The etiology can be infection, trauma, allergy, neoplasm, an infected cyst, orantral communication, displaced tooth or root, blockage of the ostium of the maxillary sinus. So all these things can lead to the disease. Maxillary sinus. So acute maxillary sinus, the extraoral signs are tenderness, anesthesia, swelling over the cheek, tenderness of the maxillary teeth in relation to the maxillary sinus. Intraoral, if it is going to be an oral fistula, there going to be a discharge of pus in the mouth. So the rhinoscopy will reveal pus drainage, edema, and erythema of mucosa. The symptoms that will be exhibited are history of cold, nasal blocking, post nasal discharge, heavy feeling in the head, constant throbbing pain, exacerbation while bending down, toothache, unilateral obstruction, foul nasal discharge. So generalized constitutional symptoms. So the difference between toothache and the sinusitis can be differentiated by asking the patient to bend down, which is a drop coin test. There will be an exacerbation of pain when the patient bends down. On transelimination, there will be radio opacity on the affected side. We already saw a picture on comparison with the normal and unaffected side. So you saw a radio opacity in the previous slide. The fiber optic light probe can be used to see, visualize the pathology of the sinus. The common radiograph that has been advised is Waters view, or it's called as occipitomental view or paranasal sinus view. So that will be acute uniform opacity due to sometimes the fluid level, or chronic shows pancytitis, fluid level and thickened lining. So the management is classic antral regime for 5 to 7 days. That is bed rest, plenty of fluids, maintenance of oral hygiene, macrolides, erythromycin or amoxicillin 200 to 500 times. The decongestants are used, the nasal drops or spray, oxymetazoline or xylometazoline, hydrochloride is the common one which is always prescribed for a nasal decongestant. Then mucolytic agents are being used. So if you talk about the antral regime, the antibiotics, the decongestants and the mucolytic agents are the three common composition for an antral regime for any form of pathologies that has been addressed in maxillary sinus. The etiology for chronic maxillary sinusitis are persistent dental focus, chronic rhinitis, chronic infection of frontal and ethmoidal sinus, and allergic conditions. The signs and symptoms are the mucous membrane of the maxillary sinus shows hyperplasia, atrophy, multiple polyp formation, degeneration of epithelium and loss of cilia and blockage of ostium, pain and tenderness, unilateral foul discharge through posterior nares. The history of repeated attack of mucopurulent rhinitis, anterior rhinoscopy, nasal condition, mucopurulent material in the middle meatus, descending exudate in the oral pharynx, oral fistula with prolapsed of polypoidal mosses. Again, the investigation are transelimination and radiograph, which is the Waters view or paranasal sinus view. The management is eradication of any dental complication, complete closure of socket if there is going to be, retrieval of any tooth or root, removal of antral polyp, antibiotics, decongestants and analgesics. The other pathology is carcinoma of maxillary sinus. It's extremely dangerous disease because the signs are not evident clinically unless it outgrows the maxillary sinus. It is not picked up more commonly in early stage. The most common type is epidermal type, and it's occasionally adenocarcinoma. This is commonly seen in men and elderly person. The first clinical sign is swelling of maxillary alveolar ridge. It can spread mesially into the nose. It causes epitaxis. When it spreads superiorly, it can cause diplopia and can cause proptosis. So the posterior spread via the pterygoid region into the interdiaphragm fossa, then it causes trismus. So anterior spread into the cheeks, swelling and anesthesia of the orbital nerve. So to outgrow the sinus, it has reached a minimum of 2.5 to 3 cm, which includes the volume. That is why it is a more dangerous disease. Treatment: maxillectomy if it is confined to the antrum and inferior structure. Maxillectomy can be total or subtotal. Radiotherapy: radium needles are inserted into the antrum and into the tumor areas. The uncommon pathology is maxillary antralithiasis. It's rarely a rare condition. Complete or partial calcific encapsulation of antral foreign body. It's an exogenous snuff paper, endogenous root tip fragment of bone and soft tissue and blood and mucus. It can be asymptomatic or pain can be exhibited. Nasal obstruction, epistaxis, sinusitis. For investigation, there will be a radiopaque mass seen in the radiograph. The commonly advised radiograph is a paranasal sinus view or a Waters view. The surgical removal is the treatment of choice for maxillary antralithiasis. Another uncommon pathology is mucosal of maxillary sinus. Involvement of mucus gland in the lining of the maxillary sinus causes the mucosal of maxillary sinus. It is asymptomatic or occasional discomfort in the cheek. It will exhibit as a toothache. The radiographs homogeneous dome shape or hemispheric radioopacity will be seen. There is no specific treatment advice for this mucosal because it disappears spontaneously. The roots in the maxillary sinus, the most common cause for displacement of root in the maxillary sinus are lack of bone or greater degree of pneumatization due to age process, due to bone erosion, or it can be due to aggressive instrumentation, or it can be due to an isolated lone standing molar extraction. The management: quick referral to a specialist if you see that you have already created an oral communication. Powerful suctioning. Rotal gauze is packed and pulled in with a sudden jerk. If all this fails, then you go for Cardwell procedure to remove the root tips of the tooth. The oral-dental communication and fistula is the common topic for a dentist, whereas the other topics overlap with more with an ENT surgeon as well. So this is more specific to a dentist or a surgeon, maxillofacial surgeon. So the etiology for oral antral communication can be extraction or improper instrumentation, periapical lesion proximate to the floor of sinus, extensive trauma to the middle third of the face. The surgical procedures are, there can be a partial maxillectomy if it is got infected. There can be marsupialization, improper incision for cardial operation. If it is due to the malignant tumor, osteomyelitis or syphilis or due to implants. The symptoms of oral-antral communication are escape of fluids from mouth to nose, epistaxis laterally, escape of air from mouth into nose, enhanced column of air, excruciating pain. Established oral-antral fistula can be pain, persistent purulent nasal discharge, postnasal drip, popping out of antral polyp, possible sequelae of general systemic symptoms. So how do you confirm oral-antral fistula? If it is a large fistula, it can be assessed. If it is an oral-antral communication, then a nose blowing test has been performed. Why the oral-antral fistula has to be closed? To protect the oral microbial flora, to prevent escape of fluid across the oral and nasal cavity of sinus, to eliminate existing oral-antral pathology. This is a picture showing on oral-antral communication. The treatment is early and late. In early, if it is immediate surgery to achieve primary closure when you are confirmed and if there is no displacement of root into the antrum, you can achieve primary closure immediately once you have noticed that there is a communication. Then start on an antibiotic prophylaxis, put on an antral regime, which is nasal decongestant, antibiotic, analgesics, or give a provisional or a temporary whitehead varnish pack on top of a denture plate to cover the fistula immediately. Whereas in delayed case, if it is within 24 hours, the wound margins are debrided or de-epithelized and can be closed immediately. If it is more than 24 hours, soft tissue margins often get infected. The surgical closure is delayed for 3 weeks. If it's going to be more than a month, then there is going to be a fistulous tract which is epithelized. So surgical closure can be done when the acute condition subsides. The surgical closure of oral-antral fistula, there is a local and distant flaps. The more common one that is practiced in oral-antral fistula is local flap. It can be either a buccal flap or a palatal flap or combined local flap. So the buccal flap is going to be straight advancement, sliding or a transversal flap, whereas the palatal flap is straight advancement, rotational, hinged, or an island flap or a combined flap. So this is a buccal advancement flap. You can see the mucobuccal tissue is being reflected and then closed over the fistula. The second picture shows the transverse of flap over the tissue. You can see the B is marked and then an arrow that goes towards the closure of the A. This is again the buccal advancement flap. This is a palatal rotation flap which has got a pedicle of the greater palatine artery. After closure, the raw area is The distant flaps are tongue flap, or there can be grafting from bone material or an alloplastic material or collagen or fiber. So the distant flap from the tongue, it can be anterior or a posterior base, depending upon the necessity or the region where it has to be transferred. These are some of the incisions that have been given and then flap mobilized for immediate closure. Picture A represents the release incision being placed to mobilize the flap to have the closure. The buccal advancement flap, you can see an incision being given, the flap has been designed. On the occlusal aspect, you can see the flap being advanced. There is scoring of periosteum at the base of the flap so that the flap can be mobilized or stretched to cover over the fistula, and the flap advanced and then sutured. On the right side, you can see a back cut being given to have more mobilization of the tissue. The palatal pedicle flap, the pedicle lingus is the greater palatine artery. You can see a raw surface that is left after on the palate, which eventually granulates. This is a picture showing a bridge flap. A pedunculated bridge flap is used to close the oral fistula. This is more commonly practiced in an edentulous one. An anterior release incision is given and the tissue is just slided over the fistula and the closure has been done. The communication or some form of trauma to the sinus can cause cross communication antral wall, like zygomatic complex fracture or LIFO 1 and 2 fractures. There will be bleeding into the cavity, or there can be a herniation of buccal pad of fat, or there can be a blowout or orbital floor. There can be herniation of periorbital flap into the sinus. All this can be detected or seen in a PNS view. The classical hanging drop sign, which is commonly seen in an orbital blowout fracture. Management is antral pack, antral balloon or Foley's catheter to reduce, and reconstruction of orbital floor and roof of the sinus with graft materials. Surgical procedure involving maxillary sinus. The intranasal antrostomy is performed to facilitate the drainage of at the conclusion of the procedure. The surgical drainage is through the medial wall of the antrum of the is punctured through the inferior meatus so that there can be drainage from the sinus. A sharp trocar and a cannula is inserted through the nasal floor in the inferior meatus turbinate so that an access can be made for the maxillary sinus drain. This is a picture showing how an inferior turbinate is punctured to release the collection in the antral floor so that there can be a drainage that can be assessed. Cardwell loop procedure, this is a method that has been commonly practiced to gain access into the maxillary sinus via the canine fossa. So what are the indications for Cardwell loop procedure? Is remove the tooth or root or foreign body from the maxillary sinus. Treatment of chronic maxillary sinusitis so that the total sinus lavage can be done. Removal of cyst or benign growth. Management of hematoma. Management of zygomatic complex fracture involving the orbit, floor and antral wall of maxillary sinus. So you can see an incision has been made. The orange line represents the incision. The area that has been marked in a circle is the area available for antrostomy. It has been opened and then accessed right below is the maxillary sinus. Once the anterior wall has been stripped off. So you can see a window being created in the second picture and then access has been gained. This is the clinical picture showing how the maxillary sinus is being accessed through orontal fistula. Sinus lift procedures most commonly practiced when there is an implant to be placed and the valvular height is not sufficient. So you can see on the right side, the osteotomy is prepared, the crestal sinus approach has been done, and then the sinus has been grafted. The sinus lift can also be done on the lateral aspect. So if the available bone is less than 5 mm and then cannot place immediate implant, the lateral sinus approach has been indicated. Whereas implant can be placed simultaneously with sinus when there is more than 5 mm of bone height, then it can go for a crestal approach, which is shown in this animation. Thank you.